An unseen virus that's forced us all to wear masks has ironically unmasked legacies of inequality and injustice. And now, as lockdowns are being lifted, communities most impacted by the coronavirus have to be especially careful. Here's what four physicians have to say.
Everybody talks about social distance, physical distances, do it. There is no other way.
As we get past this initial phase, there are going to be a lot of people who will tell themselves that they can go back to what they were doing before. And that's just not true.
Be extremely cautious. Pay attention to how you function when you go to the store or wherever you go out in public, that you are mindful of that, because any misstep can cause you to bring that virus home to your loved ones.
If you can, the whole family doesn't need to go to the supermarket, but keep the older, more vulnerable people separated from the young people. If your space is so limited that that's impossible to do, hygiene, hygiene, hygiene. Wash surfaces, wash clothes, cough into your elbow, wipe off doorknobs, wipe off the panel for the microwave, wipe off the handle for the refrigerator.
The big diseases that I see most commonly are diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, and lung diseases such as asthma or COPD, emphysema. Those constellation diseases automatically set you at a disadvantage because they are chronic diseases, diseases that run in families.
We know that COVID-19 is affecting people who have underlying conditions, and sadly, that population may not have the resources to go to a physician routinely. And so these underlying conditions can kind of fester, simmer, and then makes them more vulnerable to become sick.
What we're finding with coronavirus is that many of the patients who are gravely ill actually tend to die from cardiovascular disease. People can go from a situation where they have mild to moderate shortness of breath to having extreme shortness of breath within 2 to 5 hours.
If you have a fever of 101, 102, 103, you have nasal congestion, you're coughing, your chest feels like it has never felt before, I'm going to assume you have COVID-19 until proven otherwise.
You might see things like cyanosis, which is when your fingertips turn blue or your lips turn blue. If you're struggling to breathe, then and if you count your respirations and you're breathing more quickly than, say, 24 breaths per minute, you should definitely go to the emergency room.
There have been several reports about people having loss of smell or anosmia as the only characteristic of COVID-19, the only thing that they've had. The thing to do is for patients to contact their primary care physician and tell him or her that you're going to the emergency room. And here's why this is important. If a patient of Dr. Kirk Williams is going to the emergency room, I call ahead and say, listen, my patient is coming to the emergency room with symptoms that I think are strongly suggestive of the COVID virus. I want her to be tested. I want her to have a chest x-ray. I want her to be treated as if she has COVID virus. The emergency room they're going to have a much harder time sending home that patient because they know the patient is my patient. If you don't have insurance, but you go to a community health center, reach out to them and tell them to be your advocate.
If you have questions, ask us, ask somebody who's knowledgeable, either nurse practitioners or physicians. Call those people and ask them direct questions. You have every right to learn, and you have every right to have your questions answered.
I get patients all the time who come to me because they've been treated like less than. Even if they have good insurance, there is explicit as well as implicit bias within the medical system. There has always been a two-tiered medical system.
If you have an issue with trusting the medical establishment, find somebody who looks like you.
You may see me at the grocery store. You might see me at the cleaners. You know, you can see me as a person and not just somebody who's wearing a lab coat.
But once you establish a relationship, voice your concerns so that a doctor such as myself can validate them. I understand where you're coming from.
When I meet with patients for the very first time, I spend a great deal of time with them. I explain as much as I possibly can the details of their condition. Because when I do that, I find that they are rarely non-compliant with the kinds of therapies that I provide. Keep your blood pressure under good control. Try to keep your diabetes under good control. And they need to understand the consequences to them if they fail to do so.
The presence of stress in everyday life contributes most to these conditions. You make more cortisol in your adrenal glands, and that raises your blood pressure, causes truncal obesity, can make your sleep patterns interrupted so that you're not able to get enough rest. And that, all of those factors make your immune system weaker.
And whenever there's stress, isolation, lack of resources, child abuse does increase in all social strata. If you have a child who needs therapy, needs to talk through something, they have therapists available who can actually do virtual encounters. And mental health centers associated with county hospitals are also available.
And there are a lot of things that we do as coping mechanisms that can make certain conditions worse. Smoking, drinking alcohol to excess, smoking marijuana.
We don't know how long this is going to go on for. So establish a routine. Kids need to have a bedtime. You need to sleep properly. You need to eat well.
If you're hypertensive, you try to stick to a low salt diet, which is a 2-gram sodium diet. It's a teaspoon of salt daily. You need to look at the foods that you eat. If it's prepackaged food or frozen food, it tends to be high in salt. You probably should avoid those if you can. And if you can't, then you can rinse that food and get rid of a lot of the salt.
Exercise is so important for clearing your mind. And if you feel like I need to leave this house, put on a mask, avoid people, go for a jog, go for a walk, get some fresh air.
I do like the usage of nasal saline sprays to keep the nasal passages clear. If you have allergies, take allergy medications. I would also tell patients to wear eyeglasses outside. Somebody may cough and deposit viral particles in the eye.
And you need to actually try to put a mask or some type of covering over the child's face. You really need to remember that children can get this disease. They can spread the disease.
I think that for a lot of people, it's very difficult to be isolated or to feel isolated, physically isolated. And in some cases, it's impossible to do because we have multi-generational families and multi-generational households. We can have a phone chain. We can do a virtual worship service in which you can get your spiritual comfort without putting yourself in harm's way. We don't have to shake hands. We don't have to hug. We don't have to kiss people. We can do a symbolic or a virtual hug for people.
Listen to the physicians, the scientists.
If we follow the recommendations as best as we can stop the increase in the rate of acquisition of the disease. We can try to live smartly and consciously and be, above all else, helpful to each other. Nobody's alone. Nobody's all alone.